Hi, I'm Donna Pescow, and you're watching Ken Boxer Live on TVSB.
Terry Riken Realtor proudly presents Ken Boxer Live. From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live, Santa Barbara's one and only entertainment talk show. Let's welcome the host of the show, Ken Boxer.
Oh my God. What a fantastic group. Thank you. Thank you so much. My gosh, this is our 81st show. Thank you everyone here and at home. This is Ken Boxer Live. I'm Ken Boxer. Thanking you for being with us tonight. What a show we have. Before I tell you who we have tonight, I just want to, as I've been doing for the last probably four shows now, inviting Ellen DeGeneres. We want you here on our show, don't we, everybody? Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Ellen. That's right. Ellen, we know you're in Montecito. We want you here joining me and the group here, right here in this chair. It's here for you. We would love to have you on the show. But tonight, oh, I have to tell you, everybody in the studio at home, I've been wanting our guest to be in attendance, to be on the show for almost 4 years. This is somebody that I truly admire as an actress, as a human, as a person. Just, she's so kind. She is here for the entire half hour. You remember her from Saturday Night Fever. She co-starred with John Travolta. She was on ABC's Angie. I'm telling you, ABC Network doesn't just give you a show. She's that talented, and she's been working for, gosh, over probably 30 or 40 years now. We have her here in our studio. We got to welcome Donna Pescow with us this half hour. Yes. So don't go away. We'll be right back with Donna. Don't go away.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Palazzo Italian Restaurant, where people don't leave there hungry or thirsty. Gustafson Dance, meeting the highest standards in dance training. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. And now, back to our show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Welcome back. Joining us this evening is the versatile actress Donna Pescow. Now with over, I said, 30 or 40 years in show business, who can ever forget her co-starring role with John Travolta in Saturday Night Fever and her numerous television appearances, including, as I mentioned, her television hit called Angie. As busy as this woman is, we have her here with us for the entire show. So let's now welcome the very beautiful and very talented Donna Pescow, everybody. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm so happy to be here.
Oh, we're so delighted. First time in Santa Barbara? I usually ask a guest.
No,
that.
No. We come here, you know, frequently. It's just such a beautiful place. How can you not?
Well, we're so glad you can. Oh, you're so busy, as I mentioned. And now, it's taken me 3.5-4 years to get you here.
I just drive so slowly. It's really my fault.
Well, we're delighted. Let's go back in time a little bit. Back to Brooklyn days, where you're from. I've done a little research. Were you always acting in junior high school and high school?
I was. I think I was very hammy as a kid. And I think it was just one of those preordained things, you know. I think had I gone into any other field, people would have thought that was strange, you know. I thought, doesn't she want to be a nurse? No, she's four, she's five, she's going to be an actress.
Did you have support from your parents?
Tremendous support, yeah.
They weren't in the entertainment industry, were they?
Fringe, on the fringe. My grandfather actually was a stage manager in vaudeville, and then he was a movie projectionist. And when I was a kid, I would spend Saturdays in the booth watching movies through that little square. Mm-hmm. And he would teach me all these old vaudeville bits, you know, which were very strange to anyone else that I was friends with, you know, but to me they were hysterical. I mean, old Abbott and Costello or George Burns or Smith and Dale, and, you know, it was a weird thing for an eight-year-old kid to be doing shtick, you know, on the playground when people were just saying, just throw the ball.
Did growing up in Brooklyn have anything to do with your career in any way, in terms of shaping you up as an actress?
Maybe. I think New Yorkers, and probably people from Brooklyn, they were very extroverted. And I think that sometimes it's easier to go into show business than just be that kind of person in any other field.
But how did you lose the accent? I don't even hear
accent. Well, I went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts.
And people remember with that movie, from the movie Fame. Wasn't that where they shot Fame?
No, but it was a similar kind of thing with, like, Juilliard and the Academy. They were all sort of composites of Fame. But
you went there and...
I went there, and I had a pretty thick Brooklyn accent, and I was told, with all the other students, I came right out of high school. So, you know, you're very much a sponge, and you just kind of want to absorb everything that everybody tells you if it's going to lead you to your dream. And they said, well, if you continue to have a regional accent, you'll never work. So I learned how to lose the Brooklyn accent and do this standard American speech, which sounds like you come basically from nowhere. And then it totally screwed me up when I went to audition for Saturday Night Fever, because the casting director said, wait, aren't you from Brooklyn? And I said, yes, I am. So go home, hang out with your family, talk to people from Brooklyn, and then come back, which was a good thing, because I think I would have lost the role.
Well, can you do a Brooklyn accent right now? Is it hard to go back to that?
I don't know, Ken. You know, it's a funny thing. You know, you start to do it, and then you get locked into it. Yeah.
So tell us, I mean, the iconic role of all time, I would imagine, Saturday Night Fever. Mm. You were mentioning, how did that come about?
Well, I had not done any film yet. It was the first film movie I did. And I'd done theater, you know, little roles in touring companies and off-Broadway. And the agent I had at the time brilliantly told me it was a little part in a little movie. And at the time, I don't think there was a finished script, but I wasn't at the point in my career where I would have gotten a full script anyway. You get sides, you know, pieces that they want you to audition with. So I got these pages that didn't make a whole lot of sense, and it was a lot of improvisation. And they kept calling me back over and over, and I thought, geez, a lot of callbacks for a little nothing role. And luckily, and then I found out I think it was a Friday that I had gotten the role, and we started on a Monday or Tuesday, and that's when I read the script. And so that was kind of shocking.
It was a big part.
It was a huge part, and I was thrilled. I was thrilled, but I was completely and utterly unaware.
Well, were you aware of what it was going to become when you were filming it? I mean, there's nobody that has not seen that movie.
No,
it's everybody has seen that movie.
It's a tremendous, I mean, to be a part of an iconic film like that is just extraordinary. I don't think anybody knew how big it would be. I don't think you can ever really know that. And I think at the time, it was kind of an art film, and Paramount did it with Robert Stigwood, who wanted to really use it as a forum for his for the Bee Gees and his groups, and you know, he was very much into the music aspect of it.
Right.
But there was this wonderful script that would have been a great film without the music, and with the music was kind of extraordinary. So I think everybody just thought, oh, well, it'll be successful, but never on the level.
Well, that did you ever think that John Travolta's career would just skyrocket and the whole disco movement would come from that that one film?
I know. I don't think anybody could.
Never?
I know. But, you know, he had done Welcome Back, Kotter, and he was a tremendous star from that. And we had a crazy time filming because he had thousands of fans that would come out, and they had to give out false call sheets. So the fans would be in one place, and we would actually be filming in another place because the crowds were just crazy and loud and would stop production.
Well, you brought with you a clip from that Saturday Night Fever days. Can you give us a little lead-in, if you will?
It's kind of an Annette, the character I played. It's really sort of a composite of Annette. And
okay, very good.
Yeah.
Speaks for itself, as they say. Let's watch Donna Pescow. Saturday Night Fever, everybody.
Why don't you wait inside?
Well, I wanted to watch you come down the street. I like the way you walk.
One. Do it.
Woo!
Proud of yourself, man. Is that what you wanted? Good. Now you're a...
Yeah, baby!
Where are you going? Next.
Okay, when you see that now, was there the scene in there and the parts in there, were you comfortable with that?
You know, no, not with all of it, obviously, but
obviously.
I think, you know, it's a funny thing. I think when you throw yourself into a character, you know, and you really embrace what the character's about. You know, you're certainly conscious of what's going on and how you are uncomfortable as the actor playing it. But I think when you immerse yourself in the character, you kind of don't get that upset by the content unless, you know, it's something that's so completely unidentifiable with, you know. But I think the character, to me, she's someone everyone knows. Everyone went to school with a girl like Annette. Everyone had a friend who knew someone or was Annette's friend. She's one of those girls who just made the worst choices for the intentionally trying to do it for the best reasons, you know. And she just was really a victim of that time, mm-hmm. you know, but I don't think she ever felt that she was a victim. I think she just felt that, you know, she had a run of bad luck.
Well, did you have to learn to dance for that part? Or were you already a dancer?
Well, I was a dancer, but I had never done any disco dancing. I had not even been to a disco before we did that. In fact, several of us, not John, couldn't do it because he was too recognizable. But several of us went to the club, that's an actual club, before we started filming there to kind of absorb what was going on and see what all of that life was. And I was astounded. The dancing was so fantastic. I was just blown away that these were just kids dancing every weekend, and they weren't professional dancers. They could have been. They were just amazing. And we had a great choreographer named Lester Wilson, who was just brilliant at really finding everybody's strengths and enhancing that and making us all look really good.
Do you like thinking now back and saying that you're going to be remembered for this role for, you know, your career?
It's a huge gift, yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, I think to myself I've been really fortunate. I've had some wonderful jobs and some great roles. But if there had to be one particular thing, I feel completely blessed that this is it. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, you didn't just stay at Saturday Night Fever. Your career took off after that.
I'm so lucky. I really
weren't you,
am.
I mean, weren't you, when you were saying to yourself, okay, you were a co-starring role, and all of a sudden everyone knew you.
That was weird.
And
yeah.
Now you're getting these parts. So what was that like? That, you know, Angie came your way, and the soap operas came your way. You did so much in television.
I was really incredibly lucky, and I think because I was so naive to what the norm was, I kind of thought, oh, I guess this is how it happens. You know, you just go from job to job to job to job, and not realizing that that's not necessarily how.
I mean, you have to agree, the movie put you on the map.
Oh, totally.
Absolutely.
It totally did, yeah. And Angie came from that. I had done some other films before Angie, but Gary Marshall actually who, I mean, talk about brilliant. He pitched Angie to me, and to have Gary Marshall pitch a show is a show in itself. You know,
what was it like?
He had one line. I mean, he was brilliant, funny, warm, just one of those people that you love being in his presence, you know. So, of course, there was that. And he was also a legendary producer, writer, director, you know, just extraordinary. So, he said one thing which I thought was so funny. He said, Angie is, and he had this way he talked like this, and he'd say, Angie was the kind of girl who didn't understand how it was to live with money. So she had a maid, and her maid said to her, people, when they come to dinner parties, they like a little party favor. And so you buy them something when they leave. And so she throws a party, and then she forgets. And so as everyone's leaving, she gives them $5. She says, please, I didn't have time to go and get you something. So buy yourself something. And I fell so in love with that character. You know, so
that's a great way to get you into.
I mean, really, how do you say no to that?
That's right. Tell us now. We have another clip, and it's something that you've been working on recently.
Yes.
And
last year, there's a show everyone knows it's called The Flash, which is one of those wonderful superhero shows, and with a great cast, and they wanted to open up another sort of little arena for the superheroes and have them go to therapy. So
okay.
that's kind of where I came in.
And it's
I don't know they're superheroes, which is so they're coming in with unusual problems.
Okay. Well, let's watch Donna Pescow, everybody.
I'm Dr. Sharon Finkel.
I'm Dr. Sharon Finkel.
I'm Dr. Sharon Finkel.
I am so sorry I kept you waiting.
Oh, no, it's fine. Thank you for squeezing us in.
Oh, absolutely. I love therapy.
Oh, have you been before?
Just once when I was a kid, after my mom died.
Oh, your mom. Oh.
But I'm okay with that. I mean, I'm not okay with it, obviously. I mean, I prefer that she was alive. I just meant that I've already dealt with it. I don't think it's worth writing down.
These notes are just for me. No one is judging you guys.
The reason that we're here today is I've been experiencing some unusual pregnancy symptoms. You know, the first time I was pregnant, it was a really long time ago, and things were very different at that point. Eggs, bread, olive oil. I'm sorry, are you making a grocery list?
Of course not. I would not. So, tell me more about the symptoms you're experiencing.
So, I see you didn't go to Harvard.
No. Did you?
I see what you did there.
Donna Pescow, if you're just joining us. Is this currently airing? Is this show currently airing?
Yeah. It's. I think they're just starting their fifth or sixth season. Yeah.
So. Okay. Well, let me ask you something. Going back just a little bit, I read that you had an interesting part on a soap opera where you were like one of the first lesbian parts on daytime television.
Mm-hmm.
What was that like? What was with censorship at that time, and what was it like as an actor?
It was very groundbreaking. They had not done that, which is why they called me to do it. I think ABC, I had just finished Angie, and they wanted somebody, I don't know if they wanted somebody from nighttime to do daytime, or they wanted somebody recognizable from television. I'm not quite sure how that all worked out, but they called and said, we'd really like to do this. And we'd like to do it legitimately and really introduce a gay character and show the world that, you know, it's not some strange being, that it's just a person who's gay. And I thought, well, how could I be more flattered? You know, how wonderful to be invited to do a groundbreaking role like that.
Well, what was it like when you're doing television, like you're doing Flash, you're also doing movies? Here you're doing soap operas. You run General Hospital, One Life to Live, and another.
One Life to Live. I have to say that was for some reason it's gotten sort of blown out of proportion. I when I finished Saturday Night Fever, I had a job as an extra
Oh, okay.
On One Life. I was a hat check girl. You may remember I said hat. I was very good.
And that led to another part.
And that led to, no,
but you're, as a soap opera yep. actress, you're learning a script a day almost, right?
That's the hardest work in the world. I have so much respect for actors on soaps and writers. I don't know how they do that. That they just churned it out, and it's very good material, and for an actor, it's, you know, you couldn't ask for more because you get to do a range of emotions. General Hospital, they wanted to do kind of a comedic character, which mm-hmm. they had. It was a limited thing, you know. I was just going to be there for 6 weeks. Same with all my children with the game. It was a limited time that I was going to be there. So I think that's a gift in itself, because you know there's going to be some great character arc, and there's going to be this wonderful beginning, middle, and an end, because they've already got it in their mind
sure.
where they're going.
Did you have any influence on the writing in your character, or were you just every
day? I'd like
day?
To think so. I don't I mean, I was as surprised as anybody else reading it, yeah.
Okay. I mentioned you've been in this business a long time. You're still going
yes.
strong.
Thank you. Still going strong.
I have to ask you.
I was going to say my SAG number is 2.
That's a good joke. I'll write, I got to write that down. You were pre-Me Too.
Mm-hmm.
You've been in this business long enough to have seen it all.
Well, to say pre-Me Too,
I was before
the phrase came out.
Exactly,
yeah.
Exactly. 40 years mm-hmm. in the business. You've seen this industry. Do you have any comment you'd like to mention? Anything about what you feel about that?
You know, I can tell you that I don't know an actress, and many actors, you know, I mean, men and women who have dealt with it on some level. I was fortunate in the sense that, you know, I was able to be funny, get out of the room, somehow maybe understand what I was walking into and bring someone with me. For the most part, I think that's always an element. I also think there are a tremendous amount of decent, wonderful, caring men in the industry who would never consider that. So I think it's...
But they don't get in the news, right?
They don't get in the news. But I have to say that all of what's coming out now, I think it's a good thing, because if people don't finally have to pay the piper, it does go on. Possibly not with them, but people mm-hmm. that they've mentored.
I agree. Yeah. Absolutely. But something that I have to mention, I mentioned before the show, before on the air, somehow you and your husband Arnold mm-hmm. have been lucky and fortunate enough in Hollywood, mm. and you never hear about this. You're going to be celebrating your 31st wedding anniversary.
31 or 32. Yeah,
yes.
It's so long, I can't remember.
31 or 32. Yeah. Is it 31 or 32?
It's 31 or 32.
31. Okay. Tell, how do you do it? What's the...
I was so much taller when we started. just wore me down.
I mean, as you just mentioned just a moment ago, the industry sometimes could be terrible.
He's my best friend. He's someone I can spend 24/7 with. And he's the funniest person and the most loving person. And... still does leave the towels on the floor, but other than that, you know.
What about the toilet seat?
Well, we won't go there. We won't.
All right. What do you, you see a lot, you go to a lot of the conventions, you know, and you're signing and people are just, you know, wanting your autograph mm. and things. What do you tell up and coming actors about the business? Do you want to shy them away from it, get them not to go in this business, or would you say it's the best business you've ever been involved
if
with?
If you work. It's the best business. I say it's something that it's something you have to need, not want. It's too hard to just want to do it. If you need it to make your soul complete, to fulfill a dream or to express yourself artistically, then you have to go for it. I think the danger now is that there's a real divide between artistry and celebrity. And many people go into this to be celebrities versus to be an artist. And I don't think that people that just want to be celebrities are going to be successful, because there's no foundation there. You know, and I think it's difficult with the way the internet has changed things, and people who are very well known for their style or for something they do on YouTube or the internet that doesn't have really any substance to it, you know, and it's hard to say that's an exciting life, because it won't be, because that's all about fad and it changes. And but if you want to go out there and be an actor and really express yourself artistically, and you feel that this is your calling, oh yeah, go for it, absolutely.
I tell you, yeah. That's a great, thank you. We only have about 30 seconds left. I want the Hollywood Walk of Fame to put a star in your honor.
Oh,
they have, wouldn't that be, wouldn't you like that? Don't you deserve this? Absolutely, absolutely. Look,
Let's start a campaign.
Oh, thank you.
Oh,
so
my
much.
Pleasure.
Do you know how much
my
we
pleasure.
Just love having
thank
you? Everybody,
you.
Donna Pescow. Yes. That's our show for tonight. So for our guest Donna Pescow and for our director Nick Ferretti and the entire KBL crew, I'm Ken Boxer. Good night, everybody. Thank you all.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Terry Riken, your broker with a personal touch for all your real estate needs. Gustafson Dance, meeting the highest standards in dance training. Giovanni's Pizza, the best pizza in Santa Barbara. The Lovin' Spoonful, yogurt at its finest. The Daily Grind, espresso, juice, and deli. Spud Nuts Donuts. Palazzo Italian Restaurant, where people don't leave there hungry or thirsty. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Petrini's Family Restaurant, La Quinta Inn and Suites. Country Catering, Meat Market and Deli. Lido's Takeout. Jack's Bagels and Bistro. The Ken Boxer Live musical theme, composed and arranged by Mr. Michael J. Leslie. At Ken Boxer Live, I'm Baron Ron Heron. Good night, everyone.